Why? God.
Yeah.
Oh, it's hot as hell in here, but the air conditioner's not on. What the hell? I'll be right back.
All right. All right, so while we're waiting, does anybody remember? Welcome back, Scott. Does anybody remember if we were at the beginning of an evening or towards the end of one?
We were at the end, and we were at the estate. We all got the information from all the little outlets that we needed, and now we were going to head to the Alps. That's where we were going.
Well, yeah, but I'm talking about, like, were we at the end of a night, or did we just start a night?
I feel like...
I think we were at the end of one. Because there was a whole thing about, like, getting staked Valentino back and then feeding
him. Yeah, I feel
him.
Like that took an entire night. It feels
Sorry,
like that
guys.
Took so long.
All right. All right, negative one experience, Valentino. No, it's all right. All right, so we got Scott, we got Lucar, we got Sam. How about Daniel?
Is it any better?
I mean, it's no.
Dick.
I was trying to find a better way to put it, but no.
About now.
No, that's worse.
Fuck.
Oh, wait.
I can hear him okay.
Yeah, I heard you okay when you cursed. Maybe
I'll
just
curse from now on.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, you sound fine now. You just weren't speaking up.
You're not speaking up.
Speak up, boy.
Fuck you.
All right.
Alex is going to go to bed in like an hour.
Uh-huh.
So then I might have to talk a little bit softer.
Oh, that's fine.
Okay.
What?
Speaking of that, Scott, where are you? You're not in the room.
Scott?
Yeah. It's not just Daniel here.
What?
I don't see you in the Roll 20 room.
Oh!
You know, the platform in which we use to roll. That whole thing.
All right, everybody, remember to switch over to your character so you do the rolling correctly. All right, so with that, just like usual, any last-minute questions, concerns, comments before we begin?
Nope. I wasn't sure if we... were we going to... because I figured... Well, I guess it depends on how you're going to start this story.
Well, that clears that up.
Yeah. I mean, are we... I was... I mean, you know...
I guess what I'm trying to say, Daniel, is that were we going to send a message to the men who stayed behind for Hardestat before we left, and are you going to include that, or are you gonna, what are you gonna do with that?
You guys will have ample opportunity to make any and all decisions, don't worry.
Okay, so we're not just jumping into, like, the next part?
As much as I wish. No. No, there's some things that need to be handled, you know, I gotta give you guys freedom to make your own decisions. I can't just be like, here's your scene. Go.
Oh, darn it. Okay.
Yeah, that can be fun sometimes. All right, anyway.
Okay, hold on one sec.
Are you being for real? Like,
no, I'm like literally like 5 seconds.
All right. God damn it, Daniel.
Son of a bitch.
It's been 5 seconds.
Yeah, I was about to say that. It's been 5 seconds. Okay, I've eaten like 3 sunflower seeds since he's been gone. For me, that's a feat.
You're gonna be so healthy.
Sunflower seeds aren't healthy.
No, you're gonna get really healthy during these times that Daniel goes and comes back.
Welcome back, Daniel.
A lot of sodium.
Yeah, well, joke's on you. I'm eating the Flamas flavored seeds, so it's spicy.
Is that so much better?
It is, shut up. All right. We open our scene. We find ourselves at the end of a night. Just having finished feeding and speaking and conversing with the various ghouls, the Lambs of Isaac had uncovered leads, drawing them into the Swiss Alps on the trail of their foe. They found a name, Ambrogino Giovanni, apparently the one behind the theft. And hot on his trail, they found that it led into the Swiss Alps. But we find ourselves at the end of a night here. So the Lambs of Isaac are going to presumably rest for the evening. And as all four of you lay down for the day, the camera pans outward to see the manor, which sits upon the Palatine Hill alongside some of the others that are crowded around like so many shells. We see the yard work and the fences and the people coming and going and the cobblestone streets and the carriages and the powdered nobles who come and go. And we see a sped up time lapse as the sun crosses the sky and people whip by in rivers of blurs. And then finally, when the sun crests below the horizon at dusk the next night, the Lambs of Isaac awake. Everyone, roll 1d10 and add your humanity to it. Privately, of course. Everyone roll humanity. Never mind. Private humanity roll. Alright, so the first to rise this evening is Garamond de Gascoigne. We see him somewhere in the house. The camera focuses in on him. Daniel, go ahead and describe what we're seeing as Garamond rises, where he is, and what he does.
Garamond arises from a small corner in the basement of the villa that they have currently been staying. He has prepared himself a small corner in the cellar to sleep during the day. He awakens and makes sure to clean himself up, adjust all of his straps to hold his swords and his armor on, and then he'll quickly make his way out of the cellar to find Mateo.
You find Mateo waiting for you at the top of the stairs. After being your ghoul for so many decades, he seems to intuitively know when you will rise in the evening. He was all waiting for you, and you see his lean, wolfish figure leaning in the doorway at the top of the stairs as you ascend, Gehrman.
The big night, my lord.
Yes. Much to do this night. Could you do something for me?
Anything.
Fetch me something to eat. I wish to be full on this journey.
Mateo nods grimly and turns to walk wordlessly away from you. And on that note, Gehrman, you have lost a blood point for rising for the evening.
This makes the hunger very sharp in his mind. He's not craving it, but he is quite hungry, and he does wish to be fully sated before they set off on this long journey. He's going to make his way into the parlor and take a seat in one of the large-backed armchairs and kind of cross his legs and kind of wait for the others to arise.
And as Gehrman sits, the camera pans to another part of the house as Valentino de Valle is the next to rise for the evening. Valentino, fresh on the tragedy of the other night, you awaken and lose a blood point. And as the camera focuses in on you, describe where he is and what he does.
Valentino rises, his eyes starting open, in the very same bed that he emptied the life of the same girl that he saved, and although he seems to have mentally compartmentalized this act and justified it, he has not fully shaken it, and there is a distraction or a kind of distance in his gaze as he prepares himself and dons his wine-red cloak as he moves to the parlor in search of the others and in search of Gabrine.
Gabrine is nowhere to be found, surprisingly. Usually he's there to greet you, and as you walk into the parlor, Valentino, you see Gehrman has arisen before you. He awaits in one of the armchairs.
Gehrman? He nods.
I think you're muted, Daniel.
Oh, Gehrman has pulled out a small journal of what it appears to be. As he's scrying something in the pages, he looks up. Valentino, good to see you.
Yes, Valentino's eyes search the parlor. Have you seen Gabrine this evening?
Gehrman looks around the house. I have not.
And with that... Oh, sorry, go ahead.
At this point, he closes the book and puts down the quill that he was using to scratch notes in. He puts it back onto the table right next to him. Are you ready for tonight?
Far from it. He straightens out his cloak. But I shall wait for the others before we decide our next move.
Agreed.
And within the bowels of that manse, somewhere another cainite stirs with the dipping of the sun in the horizon. The last few rays are just beginning to die in the distance. Diego Vasquez, your eyes snap open as you come to and rise for the evening. Go ahead and describe where he is and what he does.
After the revelations and confessions of the past few nights, Diego has found himself rather distant from those he calls his friends. And so last night he found himself solace in the quiet and darkness of a broom closet. Not very noble, but secluded. When he wakes up, he's a bit disoriented, not remembering where he had rested the night before, but then he remembers and opens the door onto the hallway to head upstairs. Oh, sorry.
Oh, no problem. The moment you open the door, You see your ghoul, Alfonso Cordon. He is standing outside patiently in the hallway, waiting for you. You see that he has fresh clothes folded and neatly arranged for you in his arms, draped over them as he waits for you, a ever faithful valet. He gives you a faint smile as you stagger out of the closet.
Good evening, master.
He bows low at the neck.
Anyone else and I would have been embarrassed for them to see me like this. Thank you for the clothing, by the way.
I figured after sleeping in a filthy cloakroom, you would need them.
And he even begins to hand you articles of clothing. Not to the point where he's actually dressing you, although you could see Alfonso's devotion is such that he would.
Diego doesn't dress in front of him. He's not even embarrassed to do so. And puts on the fresh clothing. And he looks quite dapper now.
And Alfonso is not at all embarrassed to see you dress. You've been together for well over 100 years, longer than anyone alive has ever been married to each other. And there is some small ironic thought that comes to mind that Alfonso is the closest thing to a spouse, perhaps, that you'll ever have in this life.
That does even cause him to smirk a bit as he's pulling on his shirt.
The ghoul of your companion, Gabrin, the gypsy, he went ahead to the tavern in town. He said there was some sort of mercenary, condottiero, that your companion hired to help you through the Swiss Alps. They should be returning soon. Some of your other companions are in the parlor waiting you.
He nods. Then let us meet them there.
Alfonso bows low and waits for you to advance to the parlor before following after you.
And advance he does, with a rather stern look on his face.
And you hear voices floating into the hallway, Diego, as you walk towards the archway which leads into the parlor, and you see Valentino and Garamond awaiting there.
Good evening, Valentino. Garamond.
Valentino looks visibly anxious as he nods silently to Diego.
I hope I did not keep you waiting long.
Not at all.
Where is Bianca?
Seems she is the last to rise tonight.
Diego, my ghoul, Gabrin, have you seen him this evening yet?
Alfonso has told me he's gone off ahead.
What?
At your back, Alfonso lowers his head as he speaks to you, Valentino.
Gabrin was intent on returning to the bar where you had visited the other night, my lord. Apparently there was some condottiero that you had contracted to help us through the Swiss Alps. He was intent on bringing him to this house.
Damn it, Gabrin. Valentino looks down, irritated.
Your ghoul's impulsive. You should keep a leash on him.
Valentino flashes Diego an annoyed glare.
Of course, that's none of my business, he says, and as he takes a seat.
Garamond shoots Valentino a look, this time very still. Is this a problem?
Only a discussion I need to have with Gabrin. He seems to think that we are quite ready, and did not think it worthy of asking me.
And with that, the camera fades out to another part of the house, as some minutes later, another canite stirs within the bowels of this manse. The camera focuses in Bianca Dispenser, once known as Julietta de Florence, in her lovely face. We see in her repose the face we once knew of Julietta. We see her as we knew her then, so many centuries ago. For in her sleep, she looks as she was at the time of her death, not as the face she shows to the world. And as she rises, just with the last rays of the sun dying outside, go ahead and tell us where Julietta is and what she does as she rises and prepares to become Bianca Dispenser for yet another night.
Bianca would rise. She has decided since Robert's departure to sleep down in the cellars. She doesn't trust anyone very easily that's staying within this house at the moment, and therefore her usual slumber, which would be in one of the more eloquent rooms on the second floor. She doesn't trust sleeping in them without Robert, so she had decided to stay in the cellars, and when she wakes, she slips from the small bed that she had quickly made for herself the previous night, and stands quickly. She's kind of consumed with thought at the moment as she pulls a small silk robe that she had brought along with her slip around herself and makes her way to the small would it be ladder or stone staircase to get up to the first floor?
The manor is large enough and impressive enough that the staircase leading up out of the cellar is actually a sturdy stone staircase.
Okay. Before she does so, before she makes her way up, though, are there any servants left in the house?
They are, although they seem to have kept to themselves, and with this time of night, none of them are attending to their duties. Most of their duties are concerned with daylight activities, such as dusting and keeping the house as presentable as possible. And with the eerie goings-on in the house, many of them have become unnerved. You know that if you needed to, however, you could find them in the servants' quarters.
Okay. She would probably wish to feed upon one of them before heading up to her rooms and getting dressed and such.
All right. So you mean to head for the servants' quarters then?
Yes.
The servants' quarters is actually housed in a small partition at the back of the manor. There is a hidden door which leads into the walls, which consequently leads you into a small, dimly lit hallway. The light of candles illuminate your bare feet as you walk towards, and we see the face of Bianca Dispenser as she emerges in this shadowy hallway. You see the individual rooms that have been separated from each other. Their relative doors also shut as well, although it's early enough in the evening that the servants haven't entirely retired to their beds. You can see lights flickering underneath the doorway of each room, as though they have barricaded themselves away from whatever monsters that rule this house.
Is there any way in?
The doors are shut. You haven't tried them.
She would attempt to open the door.
Okay, there are several doors in this hallway. You try, just out of random chance, the first one on your left. It turns out the door is not locked, and in fact, the iron handle clicks as you push down on it.
Also, before we go on, did she use her obfuscate to become Bianca, or has she?
You did not state you did not, no.
Okay, because right now I was assuming she still had her face, her normal, her Julieta face.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, yeah, so right now she's Julieta. So she would gently unhook the latch of the doorknob and push it forward just somewhat to peer inside and see who's within.
What we see as Julieta opens up that door is a man inside. He's a man fairly well built. He appears to be a groundskeeper of some kind with the way his hands are calloused. He's naked from the waist up, and his breeches are pulled up to his knees, and we see his bare feet, and he's actually standing before a wash basin with his back turned towards the door. He doesn't seem to have noticed you as you open the door, Julieta. In fact, he is rubbing a wet cloth along the length of his body, and you can see the glistening in his muscles as he moves, and he's humming a soft Italian tune to himself as you peer in, the cold thirst burning in the back of your throat. And as you look in on him, make a self-control roll, difficulty 8.
Actually, no, never mind.
All right, relaying the results of that. All right.
As she sees the man, and is he sitting or standing?
He is standing before a wash basin.
Okay. As she sees him washing his limbs and taking the wet cloth upon his body, she gets this sudden urge to lash out and strike at him, and seeing his naked flesh so tender and pink, and she could just easily rip him open in that moment, quite like a lamb. But this urge, it's not strong enough, it doesn't overwhelm her enough to make her act upon it. And she seems to be able to gain the upper hand in her composure as she slips through the door, still in her shift and her silken robe, and shuts the large wooden door behind herself.
He hears the sound of the wooden door closing behind you, and at the wooden thud, he turns. Signora? He says looking confused. You see that he has a very closely cropped beard on his face and a nose that looks as though it's been broken a few times with his dark olive complexion. He pauses for a moment, looking unsure of why you're here and what you're doing.
Julieta is going to attempt to use her presence. Yeah.
Okay. Go ahead and declare what you're going to do.
She's going to kind of lift her finger to her lips rather seductively and tell him shh, and kind of make her way over to him with a kind of simple seductive smirk upon her lips. I mean, it's quite clear from her body language that she's intending on doing something to him physical.
All right, so what presence power would you like to activate?
Awe.
All right. So you're going to spend a blood point and roll charisma performance, difficulty 7. Immediately, you feel the power of your blood ooze out of every pore and captivate him. You see his jaw go just a little slack and his eyes go wide as all the tension in his muscles seems to melt away with your presence. And as you approach him, you hear his voice, Signora, as he exhales, and all of the fear seems to go out of him as he... You don't know if he thinks he's dreaming or what is happening, but clearly he is putty in your hands.
Julieta would kind of ease her way over to him, and when she reached his body, she would pause a moment and gaze up at him kind of serenely and sweetly in manner, and eventually... both her hands would gently come up against his shoulders, his bare shoulders, and the tips of her fingers would just gently massage into his skin. And this would go on for maybe a minute or so before she would ease her arms around his shoulders and softly say to him in her northern Italian accent, "Shh, my love." Very gently. It's very soft. Her tone is very, very quiet. And she gives him one last little smirk before going in for the kiss.
As you massage his broad back and feel the warm vitality that is flushed throughout his skin, you... smooth your thumbs and your index finger and the pads of your fingertips across this moisture-slick skin as it glistens in the candlelight, and you're able to take in your prey with a perspective that you rarely stop to appreciate anymore. He exhales in a very quavering way, and you hear his heartbeat practically in your ears like a snare drum as you go in to administer the kiss. Go ahead and describe that and what happens.
As Julieta leans in, to his neck. She pauses just a moment, kind of giving him that fever pitch in his body because he knows that she's right there. But eventually she would press her lips in for a real kiss at first, very gently at the nape of his neck, and then maybe a bit below that until finally she would give him the real kiss, sinking her fangs into his neck gently and seductively in nature.
And as he tenses and with a gasp as your fangs penetrate his skin and that warm, rich blood fills your mouth, Julietta, how much do you intend to take from him?
Sorry, guys. It's late, and I'm kind of like, duh. Well, Bianca's a very selfish person, and so is Julietta. So there's a little part of her that, you know, feels perhaps it'd be best to only take a few from him, but in the end, she decides to take at least six. And in doing so, she knows that, you know, it's not going to be good. So I'm assuming she'd have to, you know, be prepared for him to kind of slump onto the floor or something.
Well, go ahead and describe your feeding.
She, you know, begins taking the blood from him and it kind of like gnaws at the inside of her as the heat kind of floods her body from this intoxicating liquid that she's come to love so much. But she kind of holds a grip onto him as she takes more and more.
And as you continue to feed, sucking greedily upon the artery that you've punctured with your fangs, Julietta, you feel him growing colder and stiffer and weaker until eventually he slumps and you have to actually hold him up by your arms if you wish to continue to feed from him. And indeed you do, as you continue to suck greedily upon that puncture point and draw more and more blood out of him. And eventually he loses consciousness completely and crumbles to the floor, ripped away from your mouth, which is still wet with his blood. You see that he is passed out. He looks weak and pale, like a man on the edge of death, and you know that in minutes he will be gone.
As he kind of slumps onto the floor, Bianca just kind of allows him to, and his body is just limp against kind of the edges of her feet as she stares down at him. A little drip of blood kind of against her lips as she licks it. And she kind of just looks upon her victim, examining him for a moment, before eventually leaning down and kind of tilting his head so that she can at least lick the wound clean. And then gently, with her hand kind of like messied in his curls and his hair, she would gradually let the head just slump back down onto the wooden floor and stand up once more after that.
And as Bianca rises over the fallen form of her prey, the camera is going to shift as we move to the part, another different part of the house, focusing on Guillermin de Gascoigne and Valentino and also Diego Vasquez as they sit and await Julieta with no sign of her.
After some time of waiting, Valentino, continuing to look vexed and impatient, eventually rises out of his seat. I cannot wait for her all evening. I must find Gabrine. Excuse me.
Was his intention not to come to the house?
I am not ready for us to leave. There is no reason for my contact to come to this manor yet.
Garmin kind of nods as he continues to scry something in this journal he's holding.
I will return when I've concluded my business.
And at that, all three of you actually hear the front door open.
Looks like the decision has been taken from you.
Valentino looks to the door.
None of you can see the front door from where you're actually sitting in the parlor, but it doesn't take long before you hear the heavy footfalls of men approaching. Two, in fact. It's easy for your sharpened ears and your centuries of experience to pick out the difference. You see Gabrine and the mercenary, the condottiero that you met the other night, Toby Entwistle, round the corner. Gabrine smiles at the gathering.
Ah, you are all risen and ready for the evening, I see. Excellent. Hello, master.
He bows at the waist, and Toby looks a little concerned as he, his eyes shift warily from each of you. He doesn't say anything, however.
Valentino steps forward before anyone else can. Gabrine, we need to exchange words. He turns to Toby Entwistle. Mr. Entwistle, I'm afraid you'll be delayed a bit longer. We are not quite ready to depart, as my companion here may have led you to believe.
Well, long as I get paid, makes no difference, he says, his hands moving to the girdle at his waist. Gabrine's face, however, has fallen.
Excuse us. Valentino guides Gabrine away, actually outside of the manor, to speak with him.
And as the two of them leave, the camera is going to follow Valentino and Gabrine as they exit outside. You emerge into the courtyard of the manor. Seeing the Palatine Hill in the early evening, the sky is still a bit rosy even now as you step outside, although vanishing very quickly. The lawn is very neatly cared for, and as you stand on the stone walkway up to the front door, Gabrine doesn't speak, although he looks chastised.
Once outside, Valentino turns his gaze back to Gabrine. Tell me, Gabrine, did you become my master? Do you now decide when and where our plans begin and end? Did I miss this development?
Master, I simply wanted to get the jump on things. I hope to apologize for my misstep last night. I thought that perhaps you would be pleased to have the man here so soon. I knew that you contracted him to bring us to the Swiss Alps, and lo and behold, he is here. I brought him.
Enough. I am in fact not ready. I am equally as hungry this night as the night I was ambushed and lost control. I will not leave Rome for certain danger without my full strength. You forget your place by assuming to know my intentions.
Say the word, master. I will bring you a fresh young girl.
Like you did last night,
that seems to have stopped him in his tracks.
No, you will come with me, as I apparently cannot entrust you to this task. I will be fed tonight. You will not be making any more mistakes on my behalf.
A look of horror actually crosses his face.
No, no, Master, you couldn't mean...
Clearly he seems to think that you mean to feed upon him.
I do not intend to leave any more bodies. I do not intend to lose control ever again as I did the previous night. No. I cannot have you weakened either. You will assist me. I do not entrust this task to you unsupervised any longer.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Master. I'm very grateful. I will endeavor to do better.
My intention was not to bring Toby Entwistle here until I was ready. Now they can leave without me. You see how this creates a problem.
Yes, Master. I simply believed that after last night, your thirst might have been slaked, but clearly I was mistaken.
Valentino interrupts and brings his hand up to stop him and walks past him, very irritated. Come.
Like a whipped dog, Gabrine follows after you. And as the two... Oh, go ahead.
I was going to say, this is definitely the most irritated Valentino has probably ever seemed to Gabrine in 200 years. It would be very unusual to him.
And he falls silent at this, actually. He doesn't seem to know what to do. And as the camera watches Valentino and Gabrine stalk off into the early evening of the Roman night, we're going to shift scene back into the parlor where Diego and Garamond await, left alone, relatively alone anyway, with Toby Entwistle, who awaits in the doorway, or rather the archway of the parlor, rather awkwardly, looking unsure of what to say.
Diego doesn't let him stand there long. He turns on his charms, rising easily from the chair. Mr. Entwistle, is it? And he holds out his hand.
Indeed. He reaches out to grasp your hand and suddenly looks a bit shocked at how cold your hand seems.
Pleasure to meet you.
You as well. I am Diego Vasquez, originally of Sevilla, Spain. This is my manservant, Alfonso.
Spaniards! Been a good while since I've seen your kind. Good greetings to you, and he looks a bit nervous the longer you hold his hand, and Toby actually pulls his hand from yours and massages the cold out of his palm, looking nervously at you, and then back to Gearman. And, who might you be then, eh?
Gearman takes a moment to finish writing the sentence that he was currently working on before closing the quill in the book and then looking up to him. I'm Gearman. And then he leaves it at that as he just stares at Mr. Entwistle with a very intense look in his face.
Diego actually interjects, seeing the discomfort that's appearing here. Would you like some wine? You would.
Certainly. Yes. It's very kind of you.
He nods and looks very encouraged at the prospect of drink. You seem to have hit upon one of this man's vices.
Come inside, have a seat. Alfonso, fetch this man a glass of wine.
Alfonso nods and hurries silently away to do your bidding.
Well, it's a mighty fine place you've got here. I thought that perhaps I'd be waiting outside or something, but I can see you folks treat your men proper here.
He says, still looking a bit nervous, but takes a seat anyway.
And Diego will actually activate his awe to sort of calm this man's emotions a bit.
All right, spend a blood point and roll your charisma performance, difficulty 7. For some reason, your presence seems to have failed you tonight for some reason. Perhaps it's because you're so hungry, or perhaps it's because it's so early in the evening and you haven't yet shaken off most of your sleep. You can't tell, but with your effort to bring that supernatural power to the front, you find your thirst is given an even sharper edge. Toby, however, doesn't seem to have noticed, and as Alfonso returns with a decanter of brandy and a glass, Mr. Entwistle nods thankfully.
Ah, appreciate it. To your health.
And he raises a glass before tossing back the first drink.
No, senor, to yours. And it does indeed have that rather sinister edge to it.
Toby frowns and looks down at his glass before quickly pouring another one, and you can't help but see that his hand shakes just a little bit, the decanter clinking against the fine-cut glass.
This brings back memories for Diego of how he used to chase away his fears with the drink. And also it brings him back to that night, 2 nights ago, when... Or was it last night?
It was 2 nights ago.
2 nights ago when... He nearly mauled a man to death for making him feel that again.
And as you watch him drink, roll your self-control. Difficulty 8. All right, I've relayed the results of that roll.
Diego's face becomes a bit drawn. His eyes taking on a rather melancholy cast. But he does his best to shake it off, patting his hands on the chair as he stands once again. German. Would you mind keeping Mr. Entwistle company? I'm feeling a bit peckish. I should take care of that.
Without looking up from his book. Of course. Have a seat, Mr. Entwistle.
Mr. Entwistle is, of course, already sitting, but he looks far too terrified of you to correct you of that fact.
Alfonso, I might need you for this.
Of course, Master.
Alfonso nods and seems prepared to follow you anywhere.
And indeed, Diego will take Alfonso out into the city.
And as the two of them depart, we are going to shift scene to we see Giulietta di Florence, as we once knew her, emerging from the servants' quarters, feeling revitalized and reinvigorated. Giulietta, you feel that servant's blood singing through you, lifting you up and making you feel more ready to face the challenges for this evening. You can hear voices from your sharp hearing down the hall, and it seems that your companions have already entered the parlor.
Yeah, as Julieta exits the servants' quarters and she hears the commotion of her friends down below, she's actually going to make a beeline for her chambers, where her personal effects are being held, and where she had been staying the first few nights they had been there, to get dressed and put on her masquerade once more as Bianca. And I'm assuming she doesn't get stopped by anyone.
No. In fact, you do see Diego and his ghoul, Alfonso, on their way out as you cross the house.
As she spots Diego crossing down below, she would make her way to her chambers, slipping through the door quickly and lighting a few... I'm assuming it's dark in there, so she would have to attempt to light a few candles.
Actually, the tapers have been lit by the staff for this evening in preparation for the night. So there is light in the house.
Oh, okay. Well, then she would go about dressing herself. She picks a pink gown of silk and silks and cashmere from her trunk and pulls it out, finding the matching pair of shoes that go with it. And she would dress quickly, slipping on her underclothing first, her skirts, her hoop skirt, etc., before pulling on her actual gown. And as she does this, she would also spend a blood point in flushing her skin to appear more human.
And as you become Bianca Dispenser once more this night and flush this blood through your tissues and see that rosy that rosy complexion rise in your skin once more, you almost look quite human as you admire yourself. There is, of course, a mirror nearby.
She would do so, walking over to the mirror and adjusting her gown, which she had slipped upon her, and fixing the lace at her wrists, and then eventually making her way to the bed to place her heels upon the soles of her feet. All the while, she continuously would look up at her reflection, kind of lifting her chin to some degree, making sure that she appears once more as Bianca and not as Julieta. And her thoughts are kind of scattered this night as she, bedazzles herself. But she is focused on the task at hand, which is their next part of the journey, traveling to the Alps. And she knows that she needs to most likely arrange some sort of transportation for them to leave, probably within the next hour or so. She doesn't think that they'd probably dawdle much longer in Rome.
And as Julieta, or rather Bianca, as she has become, entertains these thoughts, the camera is going to shift away from her. We're going to emerge in a new scene out onto the streets of Rome as Valentino di Vaia and his manservant, the gypsy knifeman Gabrine, wander the mean streets of Rome as the early night has begun to come into full swing. Valentino, you see the signs of life all around you, and people pass you by in the street as you walk with determination towards your next destination.
Valentino's goal here is to completely sate himself. He has an intense dread, almost a fixation with not ever losing control like he did before, and he feels the only way he can ensure that is to be completely sated. But he does not want to kill anyone else that he has already started adding to the body count, so he is intending on feeding from several different women this evening, and hoping to use Gabrine to expedite that process in finding and luring them away.
Gabrine has remained silent all throughout this walk, although brash as he always is, he seems to pluck up the courage to finally speak after a few minutes of walking.
Perhaps, sir?
He says, ducking in closer to your side as you walk along this road of the Palatine Hill. He's pointing out, of course, some of the powdered nobles who are coming and going. Several houses are actually open tonight, hosting parties and galas. Some of them are even dressed for the occasion, holding their masks.
A lot of pretty powdered blue bloods in this part of town, eh, Master?
Gabrine says, smiling nervously at you.
Valentino nods, watching these women, considering what the most discreet and effective way to feed from them or hunt them might be. Can you make an intelligence roll to determine what the most likely to be successful strategy would be in this situation?
Yeah, go ahead and roll your, well, I think wits would be more appropriate here. Your wits streetwise, difficulty will be 7. It is a tough situation. All right, I'll relay the results of that roll. All right, I've relayed the results of that roll.
Valentino continues to watch these aristocrats in their masks and considers an idea, but looks to Gabrine, eyeing him up and down, knowing that he does not look the part of blending into this society, being a natural thug, but wanting him to be close all the same. I wish you to remain outside. I shall take this endeavor upon myself. This may take me an hour, perhaps longer, but I intend to do this the correct way. He looks to Gabrine for understanding.
Of course, Master.
Gabrine looks disappointed.
I shall try to hide myself somewhere here. It will not be easy. The watchmen will probably roust me if they find me, but I shall improvise.
Gabrine looks around, already looking for a place to hide.
Perhaps you can attempt to stay on the move such that no one questions you loitering in any one place. I simply need you available in the case of an emergency.
I do not wish to go too far, Master, but I will see what I can do.
Gabrine nods.
With that, Valentino steps to move towards one of these galas or parties that he sees guests entering. Or rather, he's looking for one of these, perhaps one of these men with one of these masks who may be more isolated.
Sleek and quick as a shadow, Gabrine darts off into the dark yard of an unoccupied house, and you see him vanish from sight soon thereafter. You feel reassured at his skills in skullduggery and sneak thiefing. He seems to be very talented at that. And as you approach one particular party and hear the music floating out into the street, you see that carriages are stopping and arriving in all sorts of sides of this street as people are very slowly but steadily filtering out and entering the house. The doors have been thrown wide open, and there are banners and streamers in the yard, and torchlight is just aglow everywhere as everyone is gay and making merry inside with the sound of, again, like I said, music and conversation and laughter. And you see men and women of all varying high stations of Rome coming and going. Most of the men come attended with a woman on their arm. However, you see that there is one man who is going stag, as it were. He seems to be waiting outside the party for someone before going inside, looking around the street anxiously. He's wearing a white porcelain mask and a fine black velvet cape, which conceals his finery.
Identifying this lone man, Valentino will approach him.
As you approach him, he doesn't seem to notice you at first, so intent on looking for someone out in the street, although he turns to look at you as you walk up.
Good evening,
he says, looking you up and down with an appraising glance.
Good evening, my man. I was wondering if we could have a word, if you wouldn't mind to follow me. And at this word, follow, he's going to make use of his dominate.
All right, locking eyes with the man is relatively easy. Go ahead and make your manipulation intimidation roll. That is going to be a difficulty of 4. The moment you lock eyes with him and you basically seize control of him with your iron will, your voice is like thunder to him, strikes him to his core as he slowly lowers the mask away from his face, and you see his face slack like a slapped Nancy looking at you.
Yes. I will follow you. Lead the way.
Valentino leads him away from this party towards the nearest dark alley where they can have some privacy.
There are no dark alleys to speak of, as the buildings are not tightly clustered together here. It's more the lengths of shadow stretching between different yards and fences, although that serves almost just as well as you guide him away from the light and warmth of the party. He follows wordlessly after you, and as you stop, he seems to have been in a daze of some kind, his eyes glazed over with a glassy look, the mask still held in his hand upon that that stick which holds the mask up.
Seeing that they are somewhat isolated, Valentino will give him a warm smile and reach to take the mask. Why don't you give that to me?
The man is just standing there blankly, drifting in and out of what appears to be that daze, although his fingers are limp as you take the mask from him.
Once he has the mask, Valentino will be employing another form of his gift to convince the man to leave the party. You would rather retire early this evening. You're going to go home and get into bed to get more rest tonight.
All right, and which discipline are you using on him?
Dominate level 2, subjugate.
All right. So, go ahead and roll. Of course, I am a good storyteller. I know exactly what that roll is.
Should be manipulation leadership.
Mesmerize. Yeah, manipulation leadership. The difficulty is going to be 4 once more.
Are you muted?
I think I am. He nods and turns away and wanders slightly to the left, to the right, as you tell him, and he turns his back on you, and you hear him saying, "Yes, I'm so very tired. I think I should retire home for the evening. Excuse me." You hear him murmuring, his voice trailing off as he walks away from you.
Satisfied with this result, Valentino will take his white mask and raise it up, and take the man's place, and he will enter the party. If possible, he would stand in such a way that he could wait to see if any women approach the place he was standing.
Actually, you don't have to wait long at all. You seem to have pegged this situation perfectly. As you approach the party, you see there is a lovely young woman dressed in a dress of the Venetian style, waiting anxiously with her fan in her hand, looking around for someone. And then once she spots you, she says,
"Vittorio? I scarce recognize you beneath your mask. You have such a delightful costume this evening."
Vittorio actually could not make it this evening. He asked if I could take his place as to avoid insulting you. I am no true replacement for him, but I shall do my best to entertain you this evening, my lady.
All right, make an appearance charisma roll. Or no, I'm sorry. Appearance... appearance subterfuge. Difficulty is going to be 8. She is completely taken off by this. So that's not good. As you deliver this line to her, her powdered face pulls tight with horror and revulsion, looking at you.
"Vittorio would never leave me. Who are you? Who are you? You're some kind of brigand that is... Someone help!"
She begins shouting and drawing attention to herself.
Well, she still has her face in his direction. He's going to lock eyes with her through the mask and tell her to silence.
All right. Go ahead and roll your manipulation intimidation. Difficulty is going to be 5. As you say that word, hissed underneath your breath, immediately she falls silent. Her eyes go wide with shock and horror as her fear and revulsion seem to have only grown as her lips are clamped firmly together. And you see that some of the others that are lingering around the doorway of the party have paused to look in your direction curiously.
At this, Valentino will make an attempt to wave at them in a kind of reassuring manner that it is fine.
All right, roll your charisma performance. Difficulty is going to be 8. The woman is looking very upset at your side. You're not sure if they buy your subterfuge, your performance, but they seem to very slowly at first turn away from you and head back into the party, or at least head towards the party as they were already heading that way. The woman actually make a wits alertness roll, difficulty 7. You notice out of the corner of your eye the woman means to make a break for it and run after them.
While he notices this before it happens, he will again look into her eyes and tell her to follow him.
Okay, she's turned away from you, so you'll have to grab her. And force her to look at you, if that's what you want to do.
He'll do just that.
All right, strength brawl.
What difficulty?
Difficulty is standard. She's going to try and resist you. She utterly fails in your grasp as you grip her. Go ahead and describe it, Valentino.
As soon as Valentino finishes waving these bystanders apart and he notices in the corner of his eye that this woman is moving, he quickly reaches a hand out to hook her elbow, almost as though to make it appear that he was her escort the entire time. And loops her around, turning her quickly so that he meets her eyes again. And he tells her, "You will follow me."
All right. Is that going to be a mesmerize or a command?
I'll go for a command.
All right. With the command being follow?
Yes.
All right. Roll your manipulation intimidation. Difficulty 5. With her mouth shut and her eyes fixed directly on you, she goes into that glazed, dreamy state as you feel all tension in her arms relax as she stops fighting you.
With his arm hooked around her as an escort, he will lead her into this house or estate.
All right, the two of you stride in, although she needs a bit more prodding than usual. And as you enter the house, Valentino, and join the party, what do you intend to do inside?
Valentino will, with her in tow, casually scout the house for any... is it a house? Is that an accurate description? Or a manor?
Oh yes, it's a manor home, but it's been festooned for a party this evening. Most of the dancing is going on in the ballroom at the end of the hallway. There's a wide apron staircase made of gleaming marble, which leads up to the second floor, and you see that people are congregating in the foyer and also the dining room as appetizers are being served.
All right. He will be scouting this manor for discreet corners or perhaps vacated rooms where it might be believable that a couple might ensconce away to make love or find privacy for a moment.
You think perhaps you could get her upstairs without arousing any sort of suspicion?
Then he will do just that. And lead her upstairs.
All right, and as you seclude her away in an upstairs bedroom, far away from the eyes and ears of others, she stands there like a doll, your plaything, as you close the door behind the two of you and remain in the shadows.
If there is any kind of lock on the door, he will lock the door.
Locks in this manner seem to require a key, so there is no lock that you could operate, but the door has an iron handle on it that you could close and make sure it doesn't drift open on you.
Then he will do so before lowering the mask and staring at the woman, actually not hiding how irritated he is with this woman. You're quite a fighter, aren't you? He's almost grinning at this, but the anger is more prevalent in his expression. Knowing full well that she cannot reply.
Oh yeah, she's completely under your control and seems to be drifting in and out of awareness.
I'd hoped for this to be more romantic. It is far more enjoyable, I believe, for everyone involved. When I may simply convince you that I mean you no harm. But you will understand soon that I do have genuinely good intentions. And he grins as he approaches her. And he brings his mouth to the side of her neck to begin kissing sensually, wrapping his arms around her, and then giving her the kiss to feed on her.
And as your fangs slice into her neck and you taste that sweet, exquisite nectar baking up from underneath her skin, roll self-control, difficulty 5. I'll relay the results of that. All right.
He feels the hunger within him. He is not starving, but it is still a sharp reminder in the back of his mind as he begins feeding from this woman. True to his word, he does not mean to kill the woman, angry as he is as at how close she destroyed his plan. And convinced that any story she might tell later would sound as though she was simply very obedient to some man and may make her out as a whore. So he's going to drain her of enough that he feels might make her bedridden, but that she would recover.
All right, so with that, you drain 3 blood points from your victim.
I'm satisfied with this. Is there anywhere in this room to hide her? Like a closet or space under the bed?
There is a cloakroom adjacent to this bedroom. You would have to bring her back out into the upstairs hallway in order to deposit her there. But you also could put her on the bed nearby, which is only a few feet away.
He will drag her up and lay her across the bed and turn her sideways, facing away from the door, propping her in such a way as though she simply had too much to drink or fell asleep.
All right, and with that, Valentino is sated. Or is he? Does he intend to continue hunting at this party?
He has every intention of doing as he said and hunting until he is full. So he will, as a general overview, he's going to be returning, perusing and socializing with other guests and convincing them to join him upstairs.
In the same bedroom?
If he can find a different bedroom, that is what he will go for.
Well, the manse is rather large, but it doesn't have an unlimited number of bedrooms, and you think that perhaps by leaving your victims in several of the bedrooms, there's more chance that they might be discovered. So it's however you want to go about it.
Still as an overview idea, he's planning on bringing them back to the same room, actually the one room, and more or less as he succeeds with these women, he is going to be making more use of his gifts of Cain to make them more complacent when they see that there is already one or two women asleep on the bed.
Alright, so you're going to be using your dominate in tandem with your efforts in hunting?
Yes.
It's actually, alright, so we're going to go through a series of rolls to see how well you manage to pull this off. Almost every lady here has a gentleman accompanying her. Very few are without companions, as is given the Roman style at the time. So you'll have to lure them away from their male escorts. The first is going to be a manipulation subterfuge roll. Difficulty is going to be 7. Which you pull off with beautiful and flying success, distracting the men while luring away the women one at a time. Next, you're going to need a an appearance subterfuge roll to try and entice them to follow you, at least away from the crowd enough where you can dominate them. This is going to be at a difficulty of 5, and your specialty does apply. Some of these women are quite a bit drunk, and you are very handsome. Which you pull off beautifully with flying colors, as you manage to isolate these women one at a time. It's actually child's play for you, Valentino. You find yourself quite enjoying this hunt, and why you don't do it more often. You think that perhaps parties could be the place for you, rather than feeding on these common whores. The blood of these ladies, highborn as they are, seems to have a cleaner flavor to it as you go about the night feeding. And go ahead and describe for us Valentino's night out on the town.
Although at first, especially with the first woman he hunted, it was something of a stressful occasion, but the more he got into a rhythm, Valentino found himself genuinely enjoying faking laughter at the men's jokes and pretending to make friends, leading these women away for discussions that he knows would be entertaining to them, and really just toying with them like puppets or marionettes, all the while really looking down at them, almost pitifully, relishing the control he has over the men and the women with such ease as he leads them away one by one and feeds on them to his leisure. He again remembers those days as a youth, traveling from city to city, doing very similar acts of subterfuge, but nowhere near to the success and fluidity as he does now. Feeling that he once again has regained some of this this peace that he had lost for so long, having to take on such a serious role throughout the last two centuries of his unlife.
And as you find yourself in an element that you have been long removed from, Valentino, roll a conscience. Difficulty 8. All right, I'll relay the results of that. Try to relay the results of that.
As quickly as Valentino's smile actually returns, given his thoughts, it slowly melts away, and his mouth falls open slightly. And a disappointment crawls across his face as his brows furrow, and his face wrinkles at the thought that he is really just living a lie, living a fragment of a memory of what he used to be. Almost irritated that he was actually enjoying this again. But once sated, he decides that he no longer wishes to relive the past and further this facade for what it draws forth.
And as Valentino finishes feeding, you replenish your blood pool entirely. Although you do stalk off into the night, leaving the party behind you, and all the light and warmth and life which you once knew as your own, nothing more than a mask. The camera fades out as we switch scene. And we return to the manor where the Lambs of Isaac have withdrawn. We see Germain de Gascoigne and his erstwhile company, Toby Entwistle, sitting uncomfortably across the parlor from him. Germain, your attention, which is focused upon the writing that you've been doing, is momentarily broken by the sound of the front door opening.
Garamond pauses mid-sentence as he's writing, and then shoots his eyes upwards to see who's entering.
You see Mateo stalking down the hallway and lingering in the door, in the archway just outside the parlor, nodding at you as you make eye contact before he notices Toby Entwistle.
Who is that, Master?
Garamond looks back to his book to finish the sentence he was writing. That is Mr. Entwistle. Contact Valentino.
Toby rises from his seat. Pleasure to meet you, he says, nodding. By this point, a good deal drunker than he was when he first arrived. Mateo, however, stares at him coldly and seems to cut Mr. Entwistle straight through with his cold glare, and Toby frowns and sits back down.
I have what you asked for outside, my lord.
Garamond sets the book down on the end table before rising. Good. Thank you, Mateo.
Mateo nods wordlessly, turning to cast a glare at Entwistle before looking back at you and turning away to lead the way, heading towards the front door.
Garamond goes to follow him, but just on the within the doorway, he stops and turns back to Mr. Entwistle, or Toby. You will not leave this parlor. Yes?
Righto. Just as long as I get paid. And you keep the brandy flowing.
He pours himself another glass.
Garamond looks at him and kind of scans the man over before he just decides not to add anything and just kind of shakes his head before turning to follow after Mateo.
And as we change scene, for of course we're heading outside as Mateo and Garamond stride out into the night. We see Mateo leading the way as Garamond follows after, walking around the edge of the house and across the very well cared for lawn to a shadowy face of the building that is not lit at all. We see in the dark upon the grass a dark form of someone laying upon the ground as Mateo leads you along, Garamond. You see a man who has been thoroughly and briskly beaten, his face blooming with fresh bruises. His mouth has been gagged and his feet and hands have been tied with rope. He is laying upon the grass, not unconscious, but definitely on the edge of it, blinking around his swollen eyes. Mateo folds his arms grimly over his chest as he glances at you.
Rapist. Found him in the Jewish quarter attacking a woman. I knew that's your favorite kind, my lord.
Mateo turns a sinister glare down at the man, looking at him as though he were a piece of filth.
Garamond slowly steps up and bends down before balancing on the very ball's feet, looking at the bound man. What is your name? As he reaches forward to remove the gag.
Andolini.
He glares and bares his yellowed teeth at you, trying to look fierce. But you can see fear in his face.
Andolini.
Garamond will lock eyes with him in return this intimidating gaze, though he has the weight of ages behind his.
All right, roll your charisma intimidation. Difficulty is going to be 5, given the circumstances.
Uh,
you completely cow him. Go ahead and describe it.
As Garmin locks his eyes, his brow kind of furrows, and his mouth kind of sneers, giving a very low glint of his teeth being exposed as he grabs the man with his full palm around his mouth and kind of forces his neck upwards to look at him.
Please don't kill me. Please. Please, signore. Please don't kill me.
Cameron takes a moment to look at him, to gaze upon the fear in his eyes. How does it feel to be the prey and not the predator?
He has his swollen eyes clamped shut.
The girl I pulled him off of was barely 12,
Mateo says.
This is going to make Garmin begin to squeeze on the man's face with his hands. His undead might force behind it. 12 years old. The face of innocence.
Your strength is so tremendous, your hands are like vices, like mechanical vices squeezing together. You don't even have to roll. You can crush this man easily if you want.
Garmin begins to, but he will stop just at the breaking point where he knows this man can feel the pain and the strength in his arms before he picks him up with one hand still over his face.
You have shown no mercy this night. And nor shall I.
You've ruptured several blood vessels in his face, blooming out his fresh bruises and cracks in his cheek as you have broken his cheekbones. You heard them crack under your grip, your mighty strength, your undead force lifting him easily in the air as though he were a rag doll, his ankles swinging below.
Please!
Garmin is gonna kind of take his head and start to tilt it to the side before his other hand comes up to grab behind the man's shoulder, and then he's gonna, with his full mouth extended, his fangs out, he's gonna bite into this man's neck. Except he is going to be not drinking merely from the puncture wounds, but he is gonna be ripping and really making this as painful and uncomfortable as possible while holding the man.
The camera pans back and we see in the shadows this horrifying murder unfold, this judgment upon this man as we see Garmin in his hulking form tear into this man as a wolf might tear into a sheep. We hear his screams. Almost like in a Hitchcock fashion, we just see the shadows. The shadow of Mateo lingering grimly nearby. And Garmin judging this man. Tearing him open. And ripping him apart. We see dark spray in the night. We hear guttural meat sounds. The dripping of wet flesh and blood. Garmin, as you feed upon him, how much do you mean to take?
All of it. He intends to be completely satisfied.
Given the method in which you fed upon him and killed him, you do lose a couple pints of blood in the feeding, but that is irrelevant to you. You do manage to drink enough out of his chunks of flesh and meat to be fully sated. Mateo watches the entire time, unblinkingly, unflinchingly. He has seen you do much worse.
after he is finished, Garamond still clasping what remains of this carcass. The man by his face simply holds him there with one hand as he looks back at Mateo, his face dripping in blood. I trust you can get rid of this.
There are shovels out back, my lord.
He simply holds the man out, still gripping his face and kind of handing him to Mateo.
Mateo wordlessly takes the carcass, gripping the man by two of his exposed ribs, if he can even be called a man anymore, torn apart as he is, strong enough that he can easily lift aloft the body and drag it, turning to stalk wordlessly away, dragging him around the back of the house where he can begin the process of burying the remains.
Garamond will remove a very dark and colored kind of hand towel, a hand cloth he uses, and he'll just begin to start wiping off some of the blood, using some of the water from nearby outside to kind of tidy up his face a little bit before he returns inside.
Garamond, as you clean yourself up, make a conscience roll, difficulty 5. All right, I've relayed the results of that.
As Garamond finishes, he looks at the towel and merely pockets it inside his tunic as he straightens himself up and adjusts his sleeves and the white filigree around them as he begins to, as he opens the door and then trots back inside towards the parlor.
And as we change scene and open up in the hallway of the manor, you see Bianca emerging from downstairs, Garamond, as you walk inside. Bianca, as you descend the stairs to join everyone else in the house, looking radiant and flushed as usual, you detect a hint of blood on Garamond. You smell it, sharp and beautiful. It's a bit dirty, this blood that he has been feeding upon, but it is a note that captivates your attention nonetheless.
As Bianca makes her way from the staircase, taking the few steps needed to cross the threshold and allowing her eyes to scan over Garamond as he re-enters the estate, there's a sort of darkness in her gaze as she looks to him, and if he looks onto her, he can read her expression. It's very clear. There's somewhat of a judgment there. Perhaps it's because she feels as though he is always judging her, but it is clear that he has just fed. And somewhat of a small smirk tugs at the corner of her lips before she speaks to him. Garamond.
Julietta. As he does a small attempt at what is a bow. You have finally joined us then.
Yes, well, it seems I was the last to rise tonight.
Yes, and he kind of stumbles on himself a little bit. You look lovely. As he bows a little bit more.
Thank you. She kind of gives him somewhat of a solemn nod before looking over to the entryway of the sitting room. Do we have a guest here tonight?
Yes, Mr. Toby Entwistle.
Seems he is a contact, a hire of some sorts from Valentino. He's waiting for the others to return.
Yes. The man who will be guiding us into the Alps. Well, I should make my entrance to him. I am the hostess, am I not? She smiles slightly, and she would actually pass Gehrman at this point and make her way to the sitting area where Toby is.
Gehrman will follow steadily after her, intending to reclaim his seat.
And as you sit down, Gehrman, Toby glances up at the two of you, although he hardly doesn't put any effort in greeting you as you join the room, although he does stand up to address the lovely lady that is following after you.
Ah, hello, miss. He smooths a hand back as if to groom his greasy hair, the drink forgotten in his other hand. Ah, it's Toby Entwistle. A pleasure to meet you. Why, you look mighty lovely this evening.
Mr. Entwistle, Bianca takes the few steps needed to cross the small sitting area, and eventually as she encounters him, she would stretch out her gentle hand and offer it to him for a greeting.
Toby Entwistle approaches you and grips your hand gently as possible. You feel his hand is rough and calloused, of someone who's lived a very hard life, and he gives your hand a bit of an awkward shake. He doesn't seem practiced at all in courtly etiquette, but he does his best.
Indeed, Bianca would pick up on this. She's usually attuned to men giving her a gentle kiss upon her hand, but it seems that this man is from the rougher side of life, and she could very well pick up on that pretty much the moment she had walked into the room. But alas, she allows this little mild handshake he gives her and gives him a simpering smile before gesturing for him to take his seat once more. Please, take your seat. My name is Bianca Dispenser, by the way. This is my estate that I am staying in.
Oh, miss, you have a lovely home, lovely, just, and your hospitality's been very appreciated, but very much, it seems hard to believe last night I was sleeping in a stable.
He smiles nervously and resumes his seat.
A stable, you say? Huh, can you believe that, Gehrman? She looks over to Gehrman, kind of mischievously, but she does want to try and pull the crusader into the conversation.
Gehrman looks up from his tome, almost at a loss for words as what to say. He kind of looks to Bianca and then back to Toby. You don't say.
Bianca kind of smiles a bit. She would look back to Toby after a moment. You know, Toby, you probably wouldn't guess from the looks of him, but my friend Gehrman over here, I'm sure he could relate to you a quite deal bit. Don't you have any stories about sleeping in stables, Gehrman?
A Gehrman, smile.
As she says that, as she says that, your mind immediately goes back to an event in your past. Your smile is cut short as you remember. You remember.
Please.
See the face, a face you had not thought of in many centuries. He is bleeding He's clearly been beaten nearly to death. You hold him in your arms. Brother Clement looks up at you in the last moments of his life.
Do not go to that place. Crusader, I beg you. I beg you, do not.
You're wearing armor again, looking down at him. And the rain is falling all around. And the memory fades, Garamond. Fades only with the memory of the pattering rain and as he slipped away and gave his last breath. We resume in the parlor of the manse as the camera focuses in on Garamond's face, a faraway look in his eyes.
The smile that was once on his face as he is finally regaling his companions with light and cheerful chatter is quickly broken by the memories of horrible things that have happened to Garamond. His eyes glaze over as he looks back. His eyes begin to burrow and his brow knits together. No. He looks back. He shoots them a glance before quickly picking up his book again and then looking down, this time holding his head in his hands, trying to ignore that the other two even exist.
Bianca catches his short retort to her, and immediately she would kind of give Garamond somewhat of a look. No. Oh, well. That's too bad. She kind of makes a little bit of a pouty face before turning, and kind of fully turning towards Mr. Entwistle now. She would lean into him after a moment. Don't mind Garamond, Mr. Entwistle. His demeanor can be rather stern and vigorous at times, but it'll grow on you. She smiles.
Toby gives a nervous smile and doesn't say anything, but instead buries his face in another long gulp of brandy.
Bianca would notice the brandy and immediately chipper up after a moment. Oh, well, I'm glad that someone offered you something.
The Spaniards who were here earlier. Delightful chaps, really.
Oh, yes, Diego and his servant man.
Aye, that was the name. Begging your pardon, miss, is Mr. Diego, is he ill? He looked very sick.
Did he now? Bianca would kind of look back to Garamond after a moment, taking in this information, but...
Well, he was just so cold.
Toby has an uncomfortable look on his face.
Bianca would see if Garamond has any reaction to this before quickly speaking to Mr. Entwistle one more, looking back to him with perfect eye contact. Well, you see, my poor friend Diego, he does miss home, and I don't believe the weather in Italy agrees with him very much. You'll have to forgive him. I don't believe he's very ill or anything like that.
Roll a charisma subterfuge, Bianca. Difficulty will be 5. Toby is rather drunk, and he likes you. Your dazzling charm seems to win him over and smooth away any suspicion he might have.
Well, it's a damn sight worse, pardon my language, miss, on the road up to Basel. But don't worry. We will do... He blinks. What am I hired to do?
Oh, Mr. Entwistle. She kind of smiles a little bit. She finds him quite amusing, actually. Looking back to him after a moment of amusement there. Well, did Valentino not explain your charges? You are to help us get to this... What was the town called again?
Basel, miss.
Yes, Basel. Simply be a guide to us. You know, we do not know our way. I mean, the Swiss Alps. I've never been there, actually.
What? The voice seems to catch in his throat as his mouth drops.
You're not coming, are you, miss?
Oh, but of course. Can a woman not be an adventurer too?
But Toby pauses. But begging your pardon, madam, it's a rough road, very uncomfortable for the like of ye, and the Black Monastery and Basel is no place for.
He stammers nervously.
She nods some, and actually she sees the concern in his eyes and in his voice and his stammer, so immediately she kind of places her right hand upon his free hand, which is probably upon his lap, trying to ease his discomfort a bit. Oh, but Mr. Entwistle, I would not want you to worry. I am quite stronger than I look. And besides... My husband, you see, he is not here with us now, but he is financing this voyage. And he knows how adventurous my spirit is. He wished for me to go on this journey.
Very well, ma'am. As long as I get paid, I suppose. Very well.
He takes another quick drink of his brandy, and as he does so, the camera fades out to black as we close that scene for now. As we are now at the 2-hour mark, it is now 11:30. Do you guys wish to stop here, or do you want to perhaps go on for another hour? I don't know. What would you guys like to do?
Well, I feel bad because I know Scott has to work tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I personally would like to continue, but I understand if Scott has to go. I mean, you know, work is work.
Damn it.
Scott, if you need to get some sleep, you just say the word, man.
Yeah, it's up to you, man.
I do.
All right. That's cool.
Yeah, I think that's fair. I'm getting pretty tired, and I think our roleplay abilities will diminish rapidly.
Fair enough, man. Good point. But I had a lot of fun tonight, guys. We didn't advance the story so much, but man, it's just cool. I let you guys do your thing, and you get into these interesting scenes.
Yeah, very fun. I'm very glad you spoke up about this.
Yeah, I'm glad we did this. It's kind of like a an interlude, you know, right? Between chapters, like...
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Anyway, that was a lot of fun. I really enjoyed that. Everybody's going to get an experience point tonight